We are still under the work about making silicon. From SiO2, we went up to yesterday creation of polycrystalline rods using Siemens process. And then we want to create now single crystal silicon wafers, and we proceed further. And the process which is possible in the case of silicon is there are many, most of the materials can be grown in two techniques. There are two standard processes which allow single crystal highly pure silicon rod to be pulled, and these two techniques are called CZ technique and FZ technique. Though the names are the full forms are different, but short forms are similar, CZ and FZ. One is Okralski technique and the other is float zone technique. In the case of Okralski technique, most integrated circuit manufacturing industries use CZ crystals, and the advantages of this process, there are very large diameter wafers can be created, very, very large size. Maybe as I said, 16 inch wafers can be pulled, whereas in the case of the other FZ, we shall see they may not be easier to be pulled. Then the second is the process is relatively simpler and much more easier to control the doping, much more easier as I say. Of course, there are disadvantages. It contains a small amount of many impurities like carbon, oxygen, iron, bismuth, lithium, many of them. Okay. Of course, not all of them in a large amount. Some of them are in parts per billion or less than part per billion. Some are in parts per million. And these are the ones which may actually create hell of a job to actually get rid of them. You will be surprised to see that the oxygen which is sitting here is a byproduct, because the way the process is done, oxygen will always be present, so is the carbon. And because of that, the any silicon process which will do will have these two standard impurities, carbon and oxygen. Both have some advantages and some disadvantages. So a CZ essentially is the standard technique called Okralski pull technique. And I repeat, larger wafers are possible only through this technique, and therefore most integrated circuit manufacturing companies use CZ crystals. Then why we are really looking for float zone? Yeah, float zone is also important. Of course, for the float zone you need CZ crystal initially, so you can say it's added process. It's damn costlier comparatively. It's impossible to grow large wafers in this technique. Of course, it has the feature, and that's why it is used often. It has very, very, very high degree of uniformity of impurities across the wafer and along the rod, as we shall see soon. And they are very highly pure silicon wafers, very low concentrations of both oxygen, carbon and iron and other impurities. Very, very highly pure material is possible in float zone. And for example, ICs may not require that much of impurity. Please remember, most of the impurities act like either the donors or acceptors in a semiconductor. So if they are donors, they will make it n-type. If they are acceptors, they will make it as p-type. And all our effort in the earlier this is to dope a material to your choice. But if intrinsically it is present there, then it is difficult to control. However, in the case of float zone, these impurities can be easily wished off. Where do you reach such a highly pure? So one can say purity of a wafer can be determined by this electrical property, which will say the resistivity. Resistivity of a sample is decided by say 1 upon q mu n plus q mu p. So if n and p's are very, very small from the impurities, then the rows are very large. Okay, resistivity of a wafer is very large. So larger the resistivity, purer is silicon. In CZ, at best you can do 100 ohm centimeter wafers, or maybe at best 150 to 200 sometimes. But in float zone, I can go up to 20,000 ohm centimeter wafers, and that's fantastic about it. The reason why we are interested in such wafers with high resistivity, 20,000 ohm centimeter, one can see if I calculate the carrier concentration out of 20,000 ohm centimeter, it will be around typically maybe one can say it is 10 to power 14, 5 into 10 to power 14 or 10 to power 14 or even sometime less. The intrinsic carrier concentration of silicon is 10 to power 13 per cc, and since actually 10 to power 10, but 10 to power 13 is the smallest value which we use as called intrinsic semiconductors. Now we come very close to intrinsic value, which means we have a wafer which is intrinsically doped, and you need such wafers to create what we call power rectifiers. We also need for LEDs or rather photodetectors, lasers. Many of these p-ion based devices actually require I type of material, and that means intrinsic wafers. There is where the large amount of expenses are spent by these people to get intrinsic, like avalanche diodes in the case of microwaves, they also need p-ion kind of structures. So all those devices which are special devices and not IC group of devices, they are actually many times require a p-ion structure, and in those cases float zone wafers are only possibility. We are also trying that for solar cell improved efficiency, and we will show you how I region does improve some efficiency, if not great way. So please take it that float zone is one of the feature that it is highly pure wafer, highly pure wafer. Now the problem starts, how do we actually go through the from the polycrystalline process? We have a lot of rod has been created, maybe. Since I can create rods of polycrystalline in the RIM reactor which I yesterday shown, and then we actually break them into pieces, and these pieces are called nuggets. Okay. Now these nuggets are used to create highly pure silicon rod which is shown here. This is a Zokrasky reactor shown here. The method is, okay, maybe one can think of it. This is the rod being pulled, this is the seed crystal, you can see a small, the way it is, you are in a some kind of a crucible, melt the nuggets at around 1412 to 1500 degree and then slightly cool it up below 1400. So it is a molten state, not fully liquid, and then you put a seed crystal from the top and touch it and starts pulling. Okay. As it touches the mold, it picks up some mold to its because of the surface tension. As it starts pulling, it becomes cooler and cooler, so it becomes solidified. So crystal starts growing up as you start pulling the crystal, single crystal above, and the orientation of single whatever grown by you is same as whatever starting single crystal you start with. So essentially this is just pulling up the rod from the melt, and there are a few things which we will discuss soon when we model it. There is a rate of pulling, and also during pulling we also rotate the many a times there are some reactors in which the whole molt was rotated, but molt is a very high density material, so at times it breaks the crucibles. So nowadays only the rods are rotated, they have their own problems, but essentially now rods are only rotated and also pulled up. Okay, so these are the two methods in which we control the growth as well as the impurity uniformity, as we will see later. Now this once, as I say, from the polysilicon nuggets are put here. Please remember this chamber is a carbon chamber, and which is essentially, or rather graphite chamber, and which is lined with silica. Now you can see the two materials I said, silica, silicon dioxide, and rather quartz liner, and also carbon crucible or graphite crucible. So carbon and silicon, carbon and oxygen are omnipresent in the molt itself, even if their concentration is low because their melting point is higher, but they are released in the melt. And when you solidify something, even part of this impurities will also go into solid. So do whatever, there will be oxygen and carbon in the silicon grown in Zucker-Raski-Pull crystals. Maybe better figure. All these figures, not necessarily colored ones, are available in Plummer's book. So if you please have a look at it some way. I repeat, this is rewritten again. You can see slightly shown here. Earlier, there used to be a bottom rod on which this crucible was kept, and that was rotated. And it was found that many times crucible is to break. So in lower newer cases now, this lower chuck is never rotated. It's only fixed. Crucible sits on it. You heat it on the arc furnace, and as soon as you start heating, it goes up to 1417 degrees centigrade, and you start pulling and also rotating to control the growth. Okay. So these are all same figures, differently shown. To show you that how actually Zucker-Raski pulls the crystal. Please remember the worries are something like this. If you see this tip where the single crystal was, the solid which actually picked up from the melt has a much larger diameter because of the curvature it has. So the depending on the kind of crystal size you initially start and kind of initial touch you do, the size of wafer is different, size of rod is different. So how much you allow it to grow along this and then start pulling. So there are tricks in that to increase the size, which is not very easy for outsiders, but people who do it very routinely. Now the tip there is much smaller than the size of the crystal which you are pulling. Okay. So once I was just telling, if you spin too much with high this, you will spin it definitely. Then it is possible that that joint may not survive, okay, between the single crystal and the grown crystal. If you pull it also this very heavily, the melt will actually climb over. So you don't want to pull it very heavily, but you want to pull with certain rate because you want to increase the size of crystal. So you will pull it, but at the same time, you will have to decide how much R and how much rotating speed you should have to have a good uniform single crystal coming out of this. Here is the same figures. These are the nuggets. You can see the better way of showing the figures. This is seed being pulled and rotated, and this is how it will look. Okay. And you can see the tip is too small. You can see the joint is hard. If you do too much, this joint will break. So there are tricks in saving this, which is not very difficult, okay, but I just want to show you how things happen. This is another picture from the real life KSX Corporation wafer company, which produces 300 millimeter silicon ingot. The larger rod is called ingot, okay, and it can be as long as 1 meter to 1.5 to 2 meters. Depending on the reactor you have. Please remember, larger the rod you pull, the machine require large heating because mold has to be larger, so cost is very high. However, cost to sale ratio decides how much size you should do. This is another picture for the same Zucker-Raski pull. This is the real life picture which is taken. This is of course an old plant in Germany from where this has been taken. Okay. Okay. So before we go to the float zone, we like to show you that Zucker-Raski pull crystals need to be doped. Right now we are not doped anything. So how do we dope them? What we do is, during this melt situation, we actually add per gram of mold some amount of impurities which you want to dope. Like p-type, you add boron, boron oxide in fact. And in case of phosphorus, you add P2O5, arsenic, arsenic oxides. So this oxygen is anyway added by you, by whether you like or you don't. Of course, boron itself can be added because boron is a powdered material. It can be added. But it's very hygroscopic. What does that mean? It picks up humid very fast. So it becomes jelly. So we can't add that so much. So we normally use powder, which is boric acid, which is available in market. It's not pure, but it's available. So you add to this, and since the melt is dissolves that, And when you start pulling the crystal, some part of the impurities also go along the mold to the surface and then to the crystal rod, okay. This is how the impurities are added in the case of CZ. Now we already said the problem with impurities incorporation is that that is the model we will like to see it, how the impurities can be made uniform. That is major worry for us, how the full rod has same resistivity or same concentration along the axial axis and along the radial axis, both sides it should be uniform doping, okay. Then only I can say when I cut the wafers, as I show you later, I will have uniformly doped wafers. If I go and buy a market, the wafers, many things we actually specify. One of them of course is, for example, one is doping, which is that is either P type or N type. The other thing they will say crystal orientation. Like say 100 oriented, then they will also specify to you resistivity. Normally resistivity is never specified one value. For example, if I am buying wafer for integrated circuit which has 10 to power 16 per cc as concentration, typically I am talking of 0.1 ohm centimeter, but they will give you a range 0.1 to 0.2. They themselves will not be sure of putting exact value. So some wafer may have 0.1, some may have 0.2, some in between. So you have to monitor each wafer before you actually load in. So you segregate those ones which are similar resistivity in one run and put in the others. Then they also specify what is called a dislocation count. We'll see this part little later. Maybe next when diffusion we start, that is number of dislocations per centimeter square. Actually it's called EDP, okay, and this is very important. Larger the number of this, worse is the wafer. Smaller the dislocation counts, better will be the wafer. So one has to actually see how much EDC or EDP you are really looking for before you buy. There is also radial resistivity variation. This is wafer to wafer. Some companies give radial resistivity variation. This is also specified. Then they specify thickness. And of course, dia is, you have ordered it, but diameter, and that also plus minus delta D is specified, okay. So when you order wafers, you have to specify in your indent itself everything, and depending on that they will give you quotations which you can then buy. Please take it, larger the diameter of the wafer, thicker will be the wafer requirement. Why? Because larger the wafer means larger is the mass it has. If you take very thin wafer, silicon is extremely fragile material. I don't say it, but if you see it may break. It doesn't, but if you handle with little, not enough care, it breaks immediately, okay. Particularly silicon crystals breaks very fast, wafers break very fast. Each crystal may cost you around $50 to $100. So think of it, if you lose one, you may be charged for $100, okay. Therefore, handling it is very difficult, a very important thing in this is. So the larger the thickness, thicker will be the, larger the wafer dia, thicker will be the wafer size, wafer thickness. Typically for maybe 6 inch wafers, I may require 500 microns of thickness, okay. 12 inch, I may have 1 millimeter thickness. And 16 inch may be even little more than that, because it should give physical support. But unfortunate part in all this, you should understand what is the economics behind. If you have larger size wafer, I have some figure later, you will get larger number of chips in same run, okay. Larger space means larger chips will come. Initially in 3 inch if you get 10, in 12 inch you will get 230, 250, 200, 300, 500 chips. The problem starts, any amount of thickness you create, it doesn't matter because the whole silicon integrated circuit processing is within first few microns, 1 or 2 microns. So if you have a 1000 micron of wafer and you only use 1 or 2 microns, now even it is less than that. Now in that case, since it's a planar process, everything is on the top plane only, few microns or even less. So that means the rest of all of it is not doing anything, it's just getting wasted. Okay. I won't say it's wasted, it has some thermal sink issue, good sometimes, but otherwise it is really wasting silicon. So that is the main problem, that larger the wafer you take, yeah, one side you may have larger number of chips, but you will waste larger silicon amount. So one has to plan how much thickness, how much, so depending on the, you know, a company decide which product they are on the cell, they decide which run line they should have. If they don't have that, they will actually go to a company which only manufactures, these are called foundries. So we will send all over this to foundry to make for us, we will not do ourselves anything, okay. Because that kind of things we don't have, so we don't want to, we'll get it done from somewhere else, okay. So that is the trick in all calculations of, you know, when you set a line, you have to think too many things before actually you are productive. And at least within start of a company, a line, it takes at least 2 to 3 years before you are on equal basis, spend money, receive money, and then profit starts. By then if the technology changes, some new products appear, this whole line may go for, okay. And there is the issue that how much investment where decides the company's success, okay. And that is why many of the people who may not be that intelligent in processing still may actually tell only go for this, this is what is going to survive, okay. These are managers who only manage and actually rule the world for doing nothing except telling, okay. Of course, due regards to them, I am not a manager or maybe good manager at all, neither man or machine or anything. Before we go to this, let me do something more interesting about this, because I am going to dope the crystal. Since I am going to dope the crystal, as I said already, in the melt itself, I will add impurities as per the doping I need. Problem of modeling is very difficult for many variety of reasons, but very important reason. If you see the, maybe next graph little clear, and then I'll come back to this. This is like the CZ process shown here. From the liquid, or rather maybe you call it melt, and the very close where the solid starts, interface is the liquid. There is slight difference between melt and liquid, okay. Melt has slightly lower density than the liquid, so we may differentiate, but some books do not, so I may not also, or I may or may not. Cl is the concentration of impurity, so this is Cl, this is Cs, we'll define and do the modeling. So we can see I am pulling a crystal from this liquid or mold, and we are pulling it and also, as I say, rotating it. Now there is a concentration of solid, concentration of impurity is going towards solid and part remaining in the liquid area. The problem is not that difficult. If I know how much it goes, I can recalculate and say, okay, how much impurity will go above. The problem is the reverse process there. There is a word which is called segregation, okay. Some impurities like to be more in one region. For example, some more like to be in the solid than in the liquid, or more in liquid, less in solid. Normally when you have same material both sides, the name given to this so called coefficient called segregation coefficient is named distribution coefficients. If you have two different materials, silicon and silicon dioxide, and impurities go through and also do reverse processing, it is called segregation. For example, boron tends to segregate in oxide than in silicon. Phosphorus tend to segregate more in silicon than in oxide when I put the impurities down. So This segregation is a process which is distinguishing impurity passing through each material. Now, in the case of solid and liquid also this process happens. Whatever you are pushing up, partly it is coming back and say it segregates down, okay, depending on of course the value of ratio of solid to liquid concentrations, okay. So, this segregation is the major cause. How much segregation you will get and how much segregation coefficient, as we shall define now, we should have so that you have more uniform crystal available. Please remember, every time some impurities are pushed down, then the concentration in the melt will increase and lower, then it will go lower above. So there has to be some balance, that uniform amount of impurities go up so that the wafer rod which is pulled has uniform doping. Okay, this is our major worry, and we like to model how many impurities can go up uniformly so that rod is uniformly doped. Though as I said, radially it is not, but vertically is mostly very good. And as I said last time, the p-type impurities which I add are boron, aluminium, gallium, indium. N-type impurities which I dope may be phosphorus, arsenic, antimony. Other impurities are omnipresent, which are oxygen, carbon, bismuth, lithium and gold, and even iron. Okay, I forgot iron. Iron and gold. Okay, all these impurities can have segregation with solid to liquid when they are present. Please remember, impurities do not differentiate when they go from liquid. They all will like to go above or come back to the liquid again. So each should be, we should know what is the segregation for each of them, and so how many impurities will go actually in solid has to be controlled. And this is the model which will allow us to find how do I do, but what rate I should pull, what spinning I should do, that uniformity is achievable.
Okay.
Segregation coefficient is the material property which is decided by the actually the band structure, or equivalently saying the atomic structure of the material. In case of amorphous material, for example, there is no actually atomic bonding. So the crux of space charge available at any given time decides how many atoms can actually allow. There is some kind of a shielding occurs. A wall is occurring, so I cannot go above, so I will be pushed down. So segregation is a property of the sizes of the atoms, as well as electrically if the impurities are going, they are stalled also by electrical fields, then they will say how, what kind of bonding it sees to reflect back itself. Okay, so these are essentially not very clearly told, we only monitor it, okay, that this is the segregation. Okay. We are not putting them. We are not putting any of these impurities except gold. One times we will do it probably, but otherwise no impurities put. They are omnipresent. Okay. As I say, in Zukrowski, carbon is the crucible is graphite. Oxygen silica quartz liners. Oxygen is silica is present there. I don't want to do anything, but it will be there. Same is, of course, the traces of bismuth, lithium and iron is very small. Iron sometimes is higher, but other bismuth, lithium is very small, but they are there. So in float zone, we actually see to it that they actually go away. That's exactly what float zone allows us to do. Okay, we remove those impurities on the one end. The basic idea is if we segregate, we all of them should segregate to one side, then the rest of the crystal is only of one kind. Okay. So that is what float zone is trying to do compared to CZ. Okay. But CZ, nothing very much I can do. I can just control to some extent. Okay. Okay. So we define the segregation coefficient, or as I say, some books call distribution coefficient. As far as melt pulls things are, you can also call it distribution coefficient. Is defined as CS divided by CL. Where CS is the concentration of solute. Solute means the impurities you are talking, or solid silicon itself could be one. In solid divided by concentration of solid. Here of course I am talking of impurities. Concentration of solute by weight in liquid. Okay. The ratio, please remember, if there are net amount of impurity, some weight has, and the crystal has some weight, So C is defined as total impurity divided by this weight is actually called concentration by weight. I'll explain you a little later. Concentration is defined by net impurities divided by the weight of the available impurity, total weight of the impurity. The ratio of this is essentially called concentration. Though concentration is always defined as per cc, but it's not per cc, it is per weight is how the concentrations are defined. Okay, so this segregation coefficients, if you look at it, there are different segregation coefficients. These are of course data available in many books, journals, papers, Google, any number, anywhere. Most important thing why I show you is this, when the impurities for P and N type, which are our worrisome, we can see from here, someone was asking. For example, bismuth lithium has a very low segregation coefficient. So they actually segregate more on the melt side and they don't go to the solid. But which has boron, for example, you can see 0.8. So it will segregate the other side, okay, more compared to bismuth lithium. Phosphorus, for example, has 0.35, arsenic 0.30, antimony 0.0, antimony is just the other way. Gallium has 8×10⁻³, aluminium, please remember aluminium has is a type 3 dopant for silicon, okay, and that's very important because this word which I am using is very important because in many older ICs when we were making aluminium as interconnects, we never did lot many effort to get what we call ohmic contacts. As soon as I changed over to copper, I have now a problem between copper material and silicon to make an ohmicity there. Whereas in aluminium, because it was a dopant, it just doped it heavily there and it made a contact there at least for P area. Okay. So earlier technologies to copper has further, though it has created a fantastic interconnect now comparatively, that one process step has increased because earlier aluminium was never sintered, it just went through. Okay. So let's come to it later. So these are some kind of impurities which are possible in silicon, okay, and these are the actual p-type, n-type impurities. We will also see later when we do diffusions that antimony is rarely used except some new sensors which are coming up now. There are a variety of reasons why antimony, you know, these are also impurities decided by where they lie in the band gap. They will give some level for their own impurity level. And depending on where the level lies, the holes and electrons can be created. If the energy required for a hole to create is very small from the impurity level, then we can say that 0.0, boron is 0.08 for example EV. So most of the boron atoms can be ionized and it can give holes. Phosphorus has 0.017 EV, so most of the electrons can go to the conduction band. So these are also choices made from electrical properties. Here we are not looking so much their electrical properties. So the decision of which impurity to use is now fixed. Either I use boron p-type, 90% I'll use boron, maybe boron plus gallium, these days that people are trying what to call complex. People are only in p-type, we prefer to use arsenic compared to phosphorus. Earlier we use only phosphorus n-type. For n-type, we only use phosphorus for 30-40 years. Of late 10 years or so, we figured out that we will have to move to arsenic. Question can be raised here, why not arsenic earlier? I mean, so what's so big? Yeah, arsenic, the way we'll go to diffusion, then I'll show you the source of arsenic, whichever we create, is arsine. And arsine is extremely toxic gas. If many of you were not born probably when the Bhopal tragedy took place, the gas there was phosgene or called MIC. This gas has a minimum, the maximum allowed quantity was 1 ppm, 1 part per million, whereas the death part for arsenic can be 1 ppb. So one can see even 1000 times less amount of arsine released in the air and you inhale, you may not have time to tell I am no more, okay. In phosphorus maybe you will say I am dying, okay. That's a joke people used to do with cyanides. They say no one could test KCN simply because by the time he realized he is no more to tell, okay. but that's only a joke. Test is known. Okay. I start with two cases we discuss. One is called rapid steering. So we are actually steering the liquid very rapidly. Other is called partial steering, very slow steering. Okay. The formulas which we want to create, we want to figure out what is K0. What do you expect K0 to be good? The concentration near the interface should be same as concentration in the solid. So ideally I am looking for K0 to be 1. How much I get and how do I improve is all that technique is about. Okay. I normally will like to get 1, but it may not be possible. And let's see how much nearest we can reach there. Okay, so we define, I think this is not given in the plumber's group. This is my own old notes. As I say, I am in 45 years in this area. So some terminology is mine, which may not be suited to new books or something, maybe some old books. And so please pardon me if you can go and read plumber's book, change over to whatever names they are putting. I have no objection. But normally, this problem is always worrying some for many of you. For example, in the case of MOS transistor, this current is given by mu C aux W by L, and I call it beta. This number I call it beta. But beta is very popularly known in bipolar as the beta of the transistors. Most of the books give K. They give a value, call this mu C aux W. But I have born in era where we used to started calling equivalent from bipolar to MOS. We say, oh, this is a gain function. Okay. So we started calling beta. Now this, when I teach beta, and then people say, well, what is K? So I say, okay, beta by 2 is K. Okay. That's true. But the way I look at it and why many new books do not, probably is the age difference. So unfortunately, my question paper will follow what I actually teach. So please follow what terminology I use, may be correct or may be not correct. Okay. Let's say Wm is the initial weight of the melt, Cm is the concentration of solute in the melt, solute means impurities. During crystal growth at any instant, remember there is a difference between Cm and Cl. Cm is at initial time before it starts pulling. Cl is when you start actually melting and going towards interface. Okay. So at any given instant near the interface value, we call it Cl, and inside the mold, initially what was available was we call it Cm. Cs, of course, as we defined earlier, is the concentration of solute in solids, other side of the when you pull. Okay. There is an interface, solid, liquid. Okay. Is it okay? Everyone, I repeat, this is my terminology, better you have it because I will not change for your sake, though I should, and current trend in the world is to change what student want, but please help me, not ask me to change for you. Okay. It's too late for me to change. Okay. But this is a similar nomenclature is available in plumber's book, so don't worry. Plumber is no different from me, but I don't know, he has used the modern names. We define S is the weight of the solute. S is defined as weight of the solute, okay, in the melt. Please note that at T is equal to 0 before the pull starts, I am talking of this, Cm is the concentration of solute in the melt, Wm is the weight of the melt. So we define weight of solute at T is equal to 0 as S0, which is Cm times Wm. This is how it is defined. I repeat, Cm is the concentration of solute by weight in the melt. Wm is the weight of the melt by weight, of course, weight itself. And weight of the solute at T is equal to 0, which I call it S0, is Cm times Wm, initial condition. Because when I start pulling, I need initial condition because some equations may come and then I'll have to put initial value. Okay. This is before I start, I defined it. Now consider between solid and liquid, there is a layer which has dw as the thickness, crystal this, which is between liquid and solid. You are pulling in between neither liquid nor solid, something different. That thickness we call it dw. Okay. Now, how many impurities will be in that? The weight for that is concentration of solute into weight, that is dw. In that small element, I just now defined C into W is the net value S. So, solute available in that dw is the concentration Cs multiplied by dw, the weight whatever you are talking about. Why minus? Because this is loss from the melt side. You are actually transferring from melt towards solid. So, this is minus sign is given to that. So, that is lost from the actual melt. These impurities have been lost. Initial weight of the melt was Wm. Let's say currently the weight is W at a given instant. Then the concentration of of the solute in the liquid is the total solute weight divided by the remainder of weight of the solute. Okay, Wm minus W is the remainder. Upper part W has gone out. Wm minus W is remaining. S by this value is defined as, I repeat, this is concentration not per cc. This is how it is defined in all metallurgical processes. Okay. So, I have a Cl which is S divided by W. Please remember, what is Cl? Concentration of solute near the liquid surface, which is total available impurity. This has gone out of melt. So, initially it was S divided by the new weight is, some part is lost, so Wm minus W. So, this is the concentration near Cl. The ratio we already said, the K0, which is the segregation coefficient, is Cs by Cl. However, we have just now said Ds is minus Cs dW, small change. Now, when the all crystal goes, we will go up to W, okay? Is that okay? Just write down. As I said, this is available in Plummer's book in some other form, but available. This is my idea. I have done it myself, so I don't know whether they follow this. Okay. They don't, I know. As I said to you, 83 December, or rather 83 January to, rather 83 July to December, I taught this first time, this course in IIT, maybe first time in India. Okay. So, some, you know, since idiosyncrasy starts in you, you start building on that and you say this is correct. So, something may not be correct, but it's okay. Okay. If I substitute this Cs in terms of K0, then Ds is minus K0 Cl dW. I just represent K0 Cs by Cl, so I put it there. I also represent Cl as S upon Wm minus W. Just now I wrote the whatever is remainder ratio. Okay. Then I say Ds by S is minus K0 dW by Wm minus W. How is the crystal grown? From initial concentration of S0 to any instant S, okay, S is changing. And how much is the weight in this is changing in the solid, you could say, or in this, 0 initially, and it goes towards total weight of this W. So, if I integrate with this condition S0 is WmCm, I get this relation which is Cs equal to, this minus sign comes because of minus W here. So, K0 Cm 1 minus W by dm K0 minus 1. So, now I have a concentration of solute in solid related to concentration in the melt, related to their weights, okay, initial weight as well as current weight and segregation coefficient. This is a simple integral you can solve yourself. What is interesting for me, I just now said for uniformity, Cs by Cl, Cs by Cm or Cs by Cl, that should be equal to 1. That is what my ultimate aim is. So, if I plot W by Wm versus Cs by Cm for different value of segregation coefficients. Okay. K0 is 0.1, 0.2. How do I adjust K? I'll see later. But as of now, if I plot for different value of K0s, I find K0 by when it reaches around 0.9, okay, which is what we are looking for, the melt, liquid and solid are almost have universal concentration, all three same, okay, very close to this 1, 1, 1 for example. You can say there is a uniformity from melt to the liquid to the solid. So the doping is as good as possible you want to get. Smaller the K value you get, worse will be the solid distribution. Best you can get, as close you reach K to the 1, you will get very uniform doped crystals. Okay. Now in this process which we did just now, we like to do little more further processing on it, and we find that K cannot be really controlled because K is something constant for a given material for this. But I can do a little trick to vary the K. This is the whole game. From this I figure out that for boron this K is known. So what do I, how do I change that K? Okay. So I said, okay, let me see if I get this value. If I reach K higher, I will be able to achieve uniform doping. So I made a trick. I don't mean I means those who have done first, maybe Jokralski and others. What we did, we said, okay, don't steer it with high speed, do it partial steering, slow steering. That has some advantage. If you are, you can think of like this, if you pull it faster and rotate it faster, the amount of liquid which it can stick will be smaller, isn't it? But if you pull it slowly and rotate also very more liquid can touch the solid area, okay. And the rate if which you are pulling and rate which it segregate down is such that this layer remains uniform. This is called stagnant layer. If you have done anyone some course in chemical engineering, all our analysis in transport there is based on stagnant layer models, okay. Air is going through, particles will move or not, how much stagnant layer you have. Every process in the life, if you actually analyze, is somewhere related to this stagnant layer. Okay. So, okay, the same model has been picked up from chemical people. Let us say the stagnant layer has a thickness delta, okay, between solid and liquid. And now you say, since it's a stagnant layer, there are two things that are happening. One is the impurities from the liquid are going to the solid by process of diffusion. What is process of diffusion? The, if there is a higher concentration, higher and lower, it will try to diffuse on the, from the, looking at the gradient. Okay. Impurities start diffusing through stagnant layer. There is also a segregation going on, which is inverse of diffusion. In equilibrium, they will be equal, because if the stagnant layer remain constant, this will remain, this process will balance each other for a given time. Okay. Initially it may be higher or lower, but later it will adjust itself. Now we want to see this, can we solve the diffusion equation and also segregation related flux back? And if we solve this, we somehow figured out, and we'll show you this figure later again. If this is my X and this is my concentration I am plotting, on the left is my solid, on the right is my liquid, and this is my delta, is a stagnant layer. Delta is my stagnant layer. Cs is that solid concentration which you are actually looking for. Okay. Now we find from here, near the solid liquid interface, or rather above the solid to stagnant layer interface, since the lower concentration is only possible because of segregation below, but on the stagnant layer being equilibrium, the concentration there can be higher. Okay. That is the fun part, because it's sticking there. So it is larger concentration here, but below it can't, because it has no force to go up. Okay. This means Cl dash at the interface is much larger. Is that clear? However, as it goes towards the process, towards the liquid, the concentration reduces to Cl value. When we calculated in rapid case, this Cl and Cl dash were same. Okay, Cl and Cl dash were same. So K was decided by ratio of Cs by Cl. But now this is not the value which is being used. Which value I am going to use now? This value, which is much smaller than this value, is exponentially decaying function. Okay. What does that mean? Cs by Cl will be higher than rapid thermal, rapid pulling case. Is that clear? Please remember this, if this is equal somewhere, Cs by Cl dash or Cl which was equal, then K value was decided by whatever the distribution available for you. In this case, depending on the thickness of stagnant layer, this concentration and this concentration will be different. Okay. Two processes, diffusion process followed by segregation process. Both will be trying to adjust each other such that depending on the delta I use. Now, question is, how do I control delta? The pull rate decides the delta. Faster I pull, delta will be larger and may break also. Smaller, and how much I rotate, how much I allow it to stick. So, depending on the pull rate and the spin rate I keep, I can adjust the value of delta. And delta will decide the ratio of Cl dash to Cl. So if I adjust this delta value, then I have adjustment of ratio of Cs to Cl differently from different delta values. Is that, madam, clear? As I change this, the ratio will be varying, so is K will be varying. And if I change K, I just showed you in the last graph, I can build the K, then I will get more uniform crystal. Okay, here is maths. Maths is very interesting, always. Many of you may not think that this course will have maths. Please take it. This course will have 30% of maths requirements. Look up your differential equation solutions little better. Different kinds of equations may appear and we may have to solve them. So let us say if we pull the crystal solid liquid interface and it is pulled by the same pull rate, let us say R is the growth rate of the crystal. Please remember, growth rate and pull rate are same, because as much you pull, that much solidifies. So growth rate and pull rate are almost same, almost exactly they are not, but almost. The diffusion coefficient of solute atoms in the liquid top portion of the melt is normally for most impurities is given by 10 to power minus 5 centimeter square per second. Now we have in this stagnant layer, please remember, impurity is diffused through stagnant layer into solid and segregation returns them back to stagnant layer and therefore to liquid. We write this is the forward reaction diffusion, diffusion equation. D into D2C by D, C is the concentration, D into D2C by DX square is the diffusion term, R into DC by DX is the segregation term, it returns back the, actually they are minus of that is equal, return means minus. Total net value should be at equilibrium must be 0, sum of this process must always be 0. So forward pushing is balanced by reverse pushing, so that the net pushes, therefore uniform. Is that clear? Therefore uniform. Okay. Is that equation clear? This is the, we'll prove this again in diffusion process when we look into. Right now you assume this is the diffusion equation which is giving a dc by dx is the concentration gradient. Second differential of that is essentially when I multiply by this is the diffusion term. This is coming from which equation? Continuity equation. Okay. So, if I solve this continuity equation, which I did, you can also solve. Then the concentration is AE e to the power minus RX by D plus B. solution of a differential equation is simple. And if I differentiate it, dc by dx is minus ar by d e to the power minus rx by d. These are the two. Why I did this? I have two unknowns, a and b. I need two boundary conditions to solve, to get this value. Okay. I need a and b, two unknowns. I need two boundary conditions. These are essentially one boundary condition, but the other one, of course, I'll come back to it. At x is equal to 0, what is the concentration? This figure we have just now. At x is equal to 0, concentration is Cl dash. Whereas at the concentration gradient at x is equal to 0, by actually using this term, is r by d Cl dash minus Cs. I have not derived it, but you can derive. In the night I finally got tired, so I wrote this. It's very easy to define from here. And if I make these two equations and substitute to get a and b, I get final term which I am looking for. Please note down this. This is the solution. These are the two boundary conditions which are used to define the solution of this. A and b can be found, and once I find a and b, please note down, because as I said, I repeat, whatever I am doing is possibly available in Plummer's book. It's not that it's different, only their names, nomenclatures may be different. But the equation will not change, because diffusion and segregation physics cannot change, chemistry cannot change, maths cannot change. So if we find new segregation coefficient, which we call effective segregation coefficient, which is called KE, effective, which is not CS by CL dash, but it is CS by CL. We solve those using the solution of that equation. We arrive at this term, k is k0 upon k0 plus 1 minus k0 e minus r delta by d. So what is r? I repeat, rate of the growth of the crystal. What is the diffusion coefficient for impurities near liquid stagnant layer interface? So one can see from here, I can adjust ke through which terms? You have only two terms, r and d, delta, sorry, not d, delta, d is constant, r and delta. Well, how delta adjust? By deciding the spin rate, and r I adjust by deciding the pull rate. R pull rate, spin rate will decide how much is the delta for it. If I adjust this r and delta, I can improve ke. Is that correct? I can improve ke. If you want ke higher, one can say from here, you should pull it little with a higher this and spin very slow, because delta is proportional to 1 upon spin speed. Okay. So if I want larger delta, which I thought will be good, then one can see from here, delta is 1 upon spin proportional to this. So slowly spin, little higher pull rate, one can get higher ke. And if I can get higher ke, means what do I get higher? Uniform doping. All the game is to show that mathematically also I can show that as a user tomorrow, one of you, let's, I may tell you now, there is a possibility, other day there is a news report, India may have first polysilicon plant, growth plant. Which year, when, only God knows, and maybe our Prime Minister knows, maybe, I don't know even that. But there is a proposal now which is almost going to be finalized. We may have around, the problem with making a plant is simple. If I make 200 million ton plants a year, is there consumption of 200 million tons of polysilicon in India? Okay. If it is not, why do I put a plant? I have to compete with the world, with the companies which are 50 year old, they will have already set up everything. My initial cost will be high, so I cannot sell cheap any polysilicon. So I will never survive if I have to market out. But if I have internal consumption, yes. Solar cell, this has come from solar cell department, so I hope it may be okay. It's not from IC group. So solar cell people have wanted polysilicon and they are now negotiating. I'm told, I'm not very sure how good people, the news released to the press and available on other places is identical. But assuming it is so, you may have a polysilicon plant in India. And as of now, they are thinking of 500 million tons per year. Hopefully, yes. So many solar cells may be made, hopefully. Okay. So you may have a job letter or at least say, sir, we have learned, we know. Or I have learned, I know. Okay. Remember me then.
If you don't spin, what will be the value of delta?
Oh, if you don't spin, delta will be infinite. What does that mean? That the solid liquid portion is now touching. There is infinite delta, essentially means there is no solid and there is no liquid, it will just jump down. Because such a large volume will pick down because the weight of solute will be so high on the top, it will just fall down. So too much spin or too much, lower spin and too much R. R is also, if I pull very heavily, that small portion, single crystal will break. Okay. So I have shown you two figures. When I rotate very heavily and I pull it heavily, I may actually lose the contact either side. And therefore, I cannot do too much. So KE cannot be made one any day, maybe 0.8, 0.7, 0.9 at best. Okay. But even then, KE 0.9 is good enough for us because it's giving relatively uniform crystals. Okay. So all CZ crystals are not greatly uniform but mostly uniform, and integrated circuits we don't bother too much about so much variation. As long as variation is less than 10%, it's all fine. Why 10%? Anyone? Circuit man. This is circuit, something to do with circuit. Why 10%? If you see particularly in digital, let's say in a digital circuit, your noise margins are half VDD. Okay. So you can see from here that even if there is a variation of thresholds, 10% is much lower than the available noise margins to you. Only in analog, this may be killing. So there you may not be able to do this, but in digital, this is good enough. Of course, in some speed it may affect you even then, because the speed is depending on the essentially this value percentage VT, because current is available to charge a capacitor. So there is a problem, variability issue, but otherwise it is sustainable. As long as I know what is the variation, I will adjust my critical paths. Okay. Otherwise, but in analog, I may, which wafers I should prefer, even float zone, but then it will be so costly that no one will buy my chips. If I make it on CZ, I am not doing well, I am sure. And also there are very few analog chips are manufactured, purely analog. 741 kitne kharidte log? Ya A to D, bahut thode. All that people buy is on chip analog. That is, there is a digital block and some small 10% is analog, mixed signal. Their technology is not analog, it's a digital. You work for the worst technology for analog, still want to give good result. Okay, that's the trick. That's why analog designs are much more interesting, because you are fighting every second, every nanosecond to get what you want. Okay, in digital, you sleep, next day it may work. Okay, so that's what digital is all about. Those who are, if I teach digital, I will tell you something else, but today I will not tell. Okay. Before I will not go into detail of float zone, you can read. Basic idea in float zone is the following. I already shown you this float zone reactor. Maybe you can see from here, you have full ingot of single crystal available to you. Okay, full ingot. You hinge it on the top and also on the bottom, and there is a coil, you can see coil, which is RF coil, which is traveling. It can move from one end to the other. That's why wherever you apply RF to this coil, by induction heating, the internal part actually also has a carbon rod there which actually receives the energy and heats. This is how induction heating is done. So once that zone gets heated, only that portion where that coil is sitting gets molten, okay. The rest is still solid. So what we do is, we start from say anywhere and keep passing this zone up and down, okay. Is that point clear? We start passing zone from up and down. Too much speed is also difficult, because if the mold moves very fast, it breaks. If it is too slow, it does not distribute well. So there is always catch optimizer. So this is called float zone. Why it's called? Because the zone of heating is floating. So it keeps floating up and down. So what happens? Everywhere, wherever it goes, there is a segregation. You come down, another segregation. So if in number of passes you go through this, because of the segregation and diffusion impurities going through this zone part, impurities finally after say 8 to 10 passes becomes uniform. Since there is no quartz or anything inside here, there is no oxygen, of course carbon is, but which is internally to it, so it normally does not interact directly to it, and therefore this is almost impurity free. So pure crystals can be grown only, so initially which crystal I got? CZ1. So I got a CZ crystal rod and I put it here and pass through number of zone passes, and then you can see from here, this is my zone, this is my solid, this is my melt or other side of this. So what happens? Impurity crosses this melt to the other side wherever concentration gradient is there. You keep moving this. When you come back, the impurity starts moving the other way. If you keep going like this, you will get almost uniform concentration of impurities across the lot. Okay, that is how float zones are actually made. Before coming here, I may tell you where the carbon segregates. Carbon normally segregates on the surface. Okay. So we try to remove that. Okay. With that process, we will show you. By doing similar analysis which I did for the CZ1, one can see CS to CM ratio can be 1 minus 1 K, similar like what we did for partially stirring case. Okay. And you can see all three impurities, if I do number of passes, zone passes, will reach maximum K value or uniformity. 8 to 10 passes of the length I push, everyone gets almost uniform concentrations. Please remember, this is the best possible crystal grown, and since it has no impurities generally, its resistivity is very high. Is that clear? That's why it's called intrinsic material. It has very few, 10 to power 13 per cc or 10 to power 5 into 10 to power 12 per cc you can obtain using this method. Okay. Normally in MOS you require 10 to power 16 per cc, 10 to power 17 now, maybe someday 18 or 19 as well. So float zone process is only used when you want highly pure crystals with very high resistivity you can attain, and you can always make doping. To make a doping, what do we do is, I just put a, for example, this is good rod and this is the doping rod which is doped by me, okay, earlier, fixed doping. So I put this, the rod which is to be doped with the one which is already available doping, and keep giving the zone passes. So the impurities from that concentration high will keep going, and finally after 10 or 12 zone passes, it will uniformly distribute. This is called zone leveling. Pushing an impurity from the source of rod to the whole remainder rod is called zone leveling. So you give number of passes, impurities distribute all along. Okay. So float zone is a very costly process. As I say, a typical 12 inch wafer is, these days are, of course, comparatively has gone down now, but it's still $70, whereas the float zone, of course, no one makes that size of wafers. 6-inch wafers is available at $450. So it's a huge money differential. So unless you are working on something which gives you money on that side, don't go for intrinsic wafers. Okay, so this, last but not the least, as I said, you These are the impurities which you see in CZ. As I said, the other impurity segregation is very small and therefore very little goes into the actual crystal. But bismuth, lithium, iron hardly go into it. They will be there in traces, but very little. However, carbon and oxygen have a large content. You can see carbon, this oxygen concentration is 10 to power 18 per cc, okay, which is very high, okay, extremely high. And carbon concentration is 10 to power 16 per cc, which is also very high. However, it looks as if the presence of oxygen also in carbon is not very good. If we thought, yes, a priori it seems to be, no, but it has some advantages also. Since the oxygen is a type, N-type dopant, it has a tendency to actually, silicon gets oxidized very fast. Silicon has the highest affinity for oxygen. So if the oxygen is there, silicon gets oxidized. It's called precipitates. Now these precipitates are more like an amorphous material. No order. Of course, I won't say zero order, but some less, much less order. Now when this some place, and if these contents are known where they are at the edges or surface, okay, then what happens that other impurities, like let's say material has carbon, gold or any other impurities, they find there is a vacancy or possibility where they can occupy a site and stay there. Okay. So many of, if you heat the wafer now with any other impurities, this precipitate actually absorbs most of the other impurities. Okay, then you remove that area. Okay, and you now have a wafer which is free from most of the impurities as well as the precipitates. So that many people thought that oxygen precipitate or carbon precipitate may actually harm us. It really doesn't as much. In some areas, if they are in the localized, yes, those wafers will go away. They are very low resistivity there, they actually burn at the end. These are called hotspots in chips. So very few areas burn, but normally they don't. Okay. So don't think that oxygen and carbon is all bad. Good, as if they are impurities and we do have a problem as such. So this of course finishes the growth part. Okay. Now a few more things we'll have to do for next time. Maybe we quickly see anything to be shown here on the figure. Okay. Okay, this is what some things we may show before, because these are only show, there is nothing to learn. This is the ingot, and I actually grind the diameters, okay, a crystal ingot for grinding, and then you actually grind it into a wafer, something like this. Maybe better, you have a wafer saw, as they call, the rod goes in. And there is a rotating matrix of nickel which actually grinds this upper surface. As I said you, most dislocations are on the surface, so they are actually removed. Okay. Same thing, better figures. After crystal pulling, the bowl is shaped and cut into wafers by using, this is how internal part of that. Okay. This is how you will get wafer. Okay. This is the age we see in the wafer, magnified one. These are how they are actually handled to clean. These are etchants in which wafers are handling, putting in together inside. Okay. And typical dimensions, as I say, is 150 millimeter to 400. And you can see weight per 25 wafers. This is 13 lbs. 150 millimeter has 1.5 lbs, okay. So less than a kilogram here, it becomes 6 kilograms for 25 wafers. So handling, can you understand the handling? Larger the mass, handling a wafer is a tough job, and that it should not break, okay. Because one wafer break means one heart breaks, okay. This is an example. If you have a 200 millimeter wafer and whatever die side you have chosen, which is 1.5 by 1.5, this may give me 88 dies. If I have a larger wafer of 300 millimeters, 12 inch, then it is 232 dies. So you have earned lot much good chips out of the same process. So the cost of wafer to the cost of processing depends which is higher or lower, will decide what size of wafers you should use. Okay, they are polishing and other thing, maybe some other day. So essentially we are now having a wafer which is polished clean, and it is always mirror finish. The way I polish the wafer, you can actually see your face much better than any mirror. Okay, so it is highly polished wafers which we actually going to use. It is also highly hydrophobic. No water can stick to silicon, but silicon dioxide is highly hydrophobic, hydrophilic. So as soon as silicon is seen, it will form an oxide immediately. So the when you see a wafer, you put into water, water sticks, which means it has an oxygen oxide on that. So the first thing you have to remove that oxide, because I want silicon surface. So this all has to be now done in an area, all etching, everything, in an area which we call fab lab, which is where clean rooms are required. Okay. So next time we start with clean rooms. What are clean? How much clean is the cleaner? This room is called class trillion room. This is class trillion. I am looking for sub class one. I am looking for a clean room which is sub 1 class, whereas this is class trillion. That means trillion particles of 0.5 micron per cubic feet floating here. I am expecting less than 1 particle, 1 cubic feet. Okay. So the kind of purity we are looking for is very important, and we will see next time what goes into purity. Thank you.